Welcome. I'm Jeff Ball, and I'm the Associate Chair of Research for the Department of Pediatrics. And it's my pleasure this morning to welcome Dr. Okan Bulut. He's an Associate Professor in the Department of Educational Psychology in the Faculty of Education here at the University of Alberta. And just as a bit of background, over the past few months, I've had a couple colleagues contact me about survey development and design and evaluation and wanting to get some additional resources and some knowledge and some skill in the area. So I talked to a friend who talked to a friend who got me connected with Okan. And as I think you'll see today and the next session next week, he has advanced expertise in this area. And we're really fortunate that he took the time to join our department today to help us along in this area. So Okan, I'll turn it over to you.
All right. Thank you, Jeff. So again, thank you for the invite. So I'm always more than happy to talk about surveys and survey design, obviously. I love surveys, creating them and giving them, analyzing them. So, and that's why it is a good opportunity for me to speak up about something that I really enjoy doing. So, all right, so we'll get started and then we'll just basically, I will just go over the details as we just move on. But basically today is part one. So we will mostly talk about just introduction to survey design, the basics of it. And after that one, we will just next Friday, we will talk more about how to analyze survey data. Once you finish collecting your data, then what do you do? All right, so Jeff already just gave an introduction about myself, but I wanted to give you some information still just briefly. Again, I'm in the Measurement, Evaluation, and Data Science program in the Department of Education Psychology in the Faculty of Education. So I'm coordinating that program, but also just again, I'm heavily involved in any kind of research activities around that. So we have this center called Center for Research in Applied Measurement and Evaluation, shortly CRANE. So as part of that center, I'm just running a lot of research activities. I'm just giving this kind of workshops and things like that. So if you have any questions about this type of work, if you're just working on this type of topics, just feel free to contact me through these channels. All right, so here's our agenda for today. So I just created four different sections, and each section will focus on slightly different things, but each one will also just depend on the previous one or just the next one. So, and after each one, each section, for example, like developing a survey plan, we will take a break and I will take some questions if you have. You can type your questions in the chat box, or alternatively, you can just turn your microphone on and you can ask your questions that way. So that's how we are going to do it. And at the end, we will still have, hopefully have some time to have some kind of like a general Q&A at the end. Download the slides. So here's the link. So if you need the slides for today, so we are recording today, but still, if you want to have a copy of the slides that I will use today, so you can definitely use the link that I'm showing here. So then that will give you a PDF copy of the slides that we are using today. And I will make sure that we just share the same link over the chat as well. So couple of resources before we get started. Obviously, I'm not the only resource to talk about surveys. If you need to know more about survey design, I can recommend this Don Dillman's book. It's a very famous book in survey design. That's one thing that I just used even when I was a student. And since then, the book kept, it has been updated several times. So, and it's getting better and better and better. So, and I would recommend that one. But if you are more into more like a classroom setting, if you want to learn it more through like a regular classroom environment, so then I would recommend our class or our course EDPY 504. It is Survey Design and Implementation. So I teach the course every winter. So typically on Mondays, you can look up the schedule on Pediatrics, but this is a full-term course starting in January, going all the way until April. And all the students start literally from scratch and they develop a survey from January up until April. So it's like a full-term project, so developing a survey. And finally, I just want to mention one course that I created for a learning platform called Pluralsight. So if you are more into analyzing survey data and if you are familiar with the R programming language, so that's an online course that I created for that platform, how to analyze survey data. All right, so let's just get started. So this is part one again. We will talk about developing the survey plan, and we will just cover the basics of like how to do, what to do with surveys, what are surveys, and how do we just create a survey plan after that. So I just want to start with this nice quote because I think that really summarizes the survey research in general. So many researchers think that surveys are simply a way of collecting information by asking questions. Nothing sophisticated or difficult, just ask and you will know. And this is a common dilemma in the field. So again, most people think that they can just start creating surveys in the morning and collect data in the afternoon, which typically results in a disaster, basically. So you get really poor quality data because you did not have enough time to think about your questions. And at the end, you are just wasting your time and also the people who participate in your survey. So that's why it's a more challenging process than we imagine. And that's why I recommend you to ask a few questions to yourself before you start with a survey project and to decide whether you need a survey. First, do you have enough time to prepare and administer a high quality survey? Typically, a high quality survey takes couple of months to prepare. So if you don't have that much of time, then basically if you are going beyond your deadline, then maybe you should avoid using a survey or creating a survey or a new survey. Basically, you can still use an existing survey that suits your goals or research purposes, but maybe you may not want to create a new survey in that case. Do you have access to needed funds and resources to conduct a survey research? Surveys are indeed very expensive to produce because you are putting your own time, you are maybe delivering your survey through an online program, you are paying for it, you are waiting. So it's not only just like cost that money-wise, it is also your time. And without enough and stable funding, and if you don't have those resources in hand, so then maybe you may want to avoid survey research because at some point you will just start cutting the corners and that's not a good thing. And are there any existing data resources that may also answer your research questions? So maybe there are already some existing databases that you can benefit from. So in that case, why would you go ahead and create a new survey and still collect data to answer the same type of question? Maybe you don't need that. So maybe you can utilize that existing data set to answer your research questions. But most of the time, again, since there's not much data going on, or we just know that our research questions are very specific, so that motivates us to go ahead and develop a survey. And that's why maybe you are here today to learn more about that one too. But again, I would recommend you to check out what else is available out there. And if there is one data source or more, so then maybe you may want to check that out first before you create a new survey. So why would you just do a survey? Why would you create one? So really quickly, surveys are very effective and efficient because basically you are creating a single tool and you are giving it to a large group of people, collect data all at once. So think about it. If this was an interview, like one-on-one interview, that would be a lot of time and effort. So, and also the surveys are quite flexible in the way that we are, we can measure different constructs. Basically, you can take a look at attitudes, knowledge, preferences, emotions, and all kinds of other thoughts and kind of latent traits that we can possibly measure among people. It can definitely be tailored to your own study. So those are really flexible tools, obviously. And again, compared to the data that you are collecting, the feasibility of the study, so the money that you are spending on your surveys is actually not that much compared to other types of studies like interviews, qualitative studies, and things like that. And also, again, you can always just get a lot of data by using surveys, and they can be both quantitative and qualitative, and that will give you tons of information to run a quantitative study, a qualitative study, a mixed method study. It just doesn't matter. So the surveys are all good for those purposes. So then how can you use your survey? So in two ways, basically. One is cross-sectional design. Basically, you can create a brief survey to learn maybe about like whether students are satisfied with online learning or remote learning, and administer that only once and collect the data in one time and analyze it, and there you go. So there's your study. Or you can run your study using a longitudinal design. So in that case, you are administering the same survey repeatedly. So for example, if you have a patient-reported outcome measure to measure or improvement or change in patient's health condition over time, you can administer that tool at the beginning of the maybe therapy or treatment and somewhere in the middle and maybe at the end, and you can have three data points to compare in that case, more like an official formal comparison of those time points to see are they getting better or are they getting worse after getting after that treatment, basically. So and again, going back to our main topic for this section, so developing a survey plan. So basically, you need to think about several things as you are developing a survey plan. So this answering these questions or thinking about these items will help you identify what you need for your survey research. So the first thing is kind of purpose. So what is the intended purpose of your survey? What do you want to get? So are you exploring something? Are you describing something? Are you just exploring a brand new idea? Are you exploring an existing idea, but maybe in a different setting? So those are the things that you need to think about before you get started. And the second thing is that you have to think about big questions. So what are the big questions that you are trying to answer using your survey? So what is it that you want to find out after your survey is over? So like maybe general research questions, one or two of them. So just to guide you through that process. Your audience, like who is attending your survey or who's going to participate in your survey. So that's kind of your target population. It's very important to think about that one, because sometimes we just think that you can just survey everybody and you just realize that you don't have access to those people, or maybe you have access, but you need additional consent or there are additional restrictions around it. So it's really important to think about who is going to take your survey so that you can design your survey questions tailored to that group. And the fourth thing is your constructs. So what are your target constructs that your survey is going to measure? We will talk more about that one, like what construct really means. But typically these are not like content areas, but they are more like broader areas that you are hoping to measure with your survey. These are the things that we hope to measure, like attitudes, preferences, emotions, thoughts. These are the things that we cannot see, but we can still measure using tools like surveys. So we call them latent traits or constructs sometimes. And finally, it's good to think about your survey schedule. So with the dates starting from your design all the way to reporting, because that timeline will give you an idea about like whether you need a survey or whether you can do a survey research in that case. And also you will plan things better in that case. So I will just show you a timeline in the next slide now. Basically, just step one is deciding the purpose, big questions, your constructs, your target audience. This typically takes 1 to 3 weeks. So this is very foundational to the rest of the survey timeline or your research. So basically take the time, identify all the purposes, big questions, constructs, and target audience for your survey, maybe with your colleagues, with other people who are just helping you in that survey project, and take your time, decide everything really carefully. In step two, we are just creating basically content. So we are just selecting the content to be covered in our survey, and we are using that content or content areas to develop a bunch of questions in that case. So, and after the questions are done, basically it's not the end of that story. So it's actually just the beginning, because we have to keep revising the questions back and forth. And finally, we need to run a pilot study to test the items or test the questions before we administer the real survey. And that will typically take several weeks. And it may sound really long or tedious, but that is also a very necessary step to get a very good high quality survey. In step three, you are determining what your survey mode is going to be. So like online survey, paper and pencil, maybe both of them. Maybe you will do it like face-to-face. So you just decide on those details. And you just put the survey items together to create a survey or construct a survey, just whatever the mode that you decided online, just put it in an online environment or in a paper, just put it in a booklet or paper format and just make it ready. And finally, you start collecting data. And depending on your research problem, depending on how complex your research is, so it may take 3 to 4 weeks to all the way to several months, actually. So you may give some time to people to fill out the survey, and depending on the design, literally it can just take several months before you see the final data set. And at the end, the final step is to get the data, start analyzing it, and based on your findings, create a report, publication, or presentation. And this is the one that we will talk about next week. But typically, survey data is not too difficult to analyze depending on the skill set that you have. But at the same time, it still requires some time to think about what those findings really mean. So in that case, I would say 2 to 4 weeks is a good timeline to run data data analysis with your survey data and think about how to report your findings. All right, so just like I said, after each section, I will just stop just like this. So I will just take some questions from the audience. If there are any, and or you can either just type it in the chat box, or you can turn on your microphone and ask your questions in general based on what we have covered so far. Any questions from the group? So regarding what we have discussed so far, the surveys, the timeline.
Hi, yeah, I have a quick question just about piloting. I don't know if you're
going to get to that,
but how do you choose your group to pilot, or where do you get those people?
Yeah, that's right. So that's a very good question. We will come to that at the end. So I have a section dedicated to piloting, but I will give you a quick answer around that. So the people, basically, I will just show you that there are several piloting strategies. So, but the people who participate in your pilot study, the real participants, should be the people that are eligible to participate in your survey later on. The interesting thing is that once you select those people from your target population, so those are the people that you expect to participate in your survey, and those people may participate in your pilot study, but then they cannot participate in your real survey because you have already administered one version of your survey to them. And sometimes when I teach my survey class, I see people asking me, hey, can I give it to my parents? Can I give it to my friends? Sure, but again, those people may give you some feedback, but it's not going to be the feedback that you are looking for, because you want the real feedback from the people who will end up taking that survey. So, and that's why I will give you some guidelines around that one at the end. So that's the those are the final slides today that I will cover. And again, even if you cannot find 15, 20, 30 people to participate in a pilot study, I will show you an alternative method to consider with fewer people and still get a lot of information to fix or revise your survey, basically. And I see one question in the chat. It says, in your experience, how much of your questionnaire needs to be done for ethics approval to be granted? That's a very good question. So before you apply for an ethics approval, basically your survey needs to be done. Unless you are just explicitly just saying that, hey, this is a pilot version of the survey and I'm just getting this ethics approval for the pilot study, and after the pilot study, I will revise my survey and I will submit an amendment or something like that, like an extension, just to revise it. That will work. Otherwise, either a pilot version of your survey, or if you're not running a pilot study, which I highly recommend, actually, just you do it. But still, let's say you are just skipping that step. So in that case, your survey needs to be done before you apply for the ethics approval, because they want a full copy of it. The consent letter, the information letter, your survey questions, everything needs to be uploaded to the ethics approval system before you get an approval, basically. So that's that. But like I said, a kind of like a nice way to take some time on that one. Again, just take the pilot study, submit your pilot version, mention that this is a pilot study. And once your survey is done, make the revisions and submit an amendment. And this time it is the full version. All right, yeah, that was a very good question as well. So any other questions before we move on? So I will just check my time. I think we are just doing pretty good so far. Again, I will give you a chance to just like ask your questions again. Even if you just have some questions right now, again, you can just definitely ask them later on as well. Feel free to just type them in the chat box. I'll be happy to answer them as much as I can. All right, so maybe then if there are no questions, I will move to the second section to discuss how to create survey questions. So, and again, this is the part that is really, really challenging, but at the same time, like I said, the success of creating high quality survey questions really depends on how much time you spent on like deciding the constructs, the purpose of your survey, target audience, and things like that. If you took your time, if you thought about those things really carefully, then you will have a good chance to create really high quality survey questions. But in other cases, if you didn't think about your purpose, if you just started creating a bunch of questions randomly, and that may not give you a very good set of questions at the end, unfortunately. So as you are creating survey questions, I recommend you to consider this four elements. So basically these are content, the wording of your items, the response skill that you will use, and the number of questions that you may need in your survey. So I will just highlight those things as much as I can in the next few slides. All right, so before you get started with your survey, obviously you have to think about your survey content and where do you get the content? So that's the biggest question, right? So your first stop would be kind of literature review. So look at the literature, if there are any other surveys similar to yours or the one that you are planning to create, or anyone that your any other survey that your colleagues may have been using so far, or maybe another researcher just used it in the past. Just take a look at those things, just to not to copy somebody else's survey, or not to take the same survey and then use it in your own research, but just to get some inspiration to see what worked and what did not work in their survey research, and what are the general content areas that they focused on, and how successful they were in measuring those things. Because people typically publish those studies and they just say that we created a survey, there were five areas, did one, the fifth one or fourth one did not work out, obviously people didn't fill it out or something happened. So maybe that's a good hint for you to think about, like maybe I should not really focus on that area in my survey, not to have the same mistake. So literature review is a good start, but after that, so I would definitely recommend you to talk to experts in your field. Who are these people? So these are people who are conducting research in this area. These are people who are practicing that in that area. So for example, if you are creating a survey that is maybe related to nursing, in that case, you may talk to some faculty members in the from the nursing program. Or you may talk to some practicing nurses. Just go and talk to them as they are practicing that job in the field. Or you may want to just talk to some people who are just actually training those nurses in the field. So basically, those are kind of content experts, researchers, anybody you can think of with some experience and knowledge around the topic that you are investigating. And that will give you multiple perspectives around what you are hoping to develop or measure in your survey. Just talk to them, just get their advices on like what to look at, what to focus on in your survey, and that would be a very good starting point. And after that, obviously, your observations. Because you are running or you're conducting that survey, that means probably you have some experience in that area too. So some of those observations that you may have so far will guide you through that survey development process. So you can rely on your own observations. Maybe you can start making some observations on the target population that you are hoping to use. Then use those observations to inform your survey question development process. So, and all of those things need to be combined really carefully because, again, you may think that, hey, this area is really important, but the literature may just say, no, it is not. Or an expert may just say that focus on this, but you may think that it is not relevant based on your observation. So you have to decide on what are the most important aspects of your survey. So this is a kind of like an example, like how do we just create a survey? We are always starting with the construct, defining a construct, what is our target construct? And I will show you an example in the following slide to illustrate this. But in the meantime, we are starting with a construct and we are just saying that my construct is this. And based on this construct, so I looked at the literature, I talked to people, experts, and based on my observations, I feel like there are several content areas that I need to cover, and each content area needs to be covered by some questions or investigated by some questions. All those like blue-ish, green-ish boxes that you are seeing in this slide, so those are individual survey questions. So basically, start with a general framework, like a construct, identify content areas underneath, and then just write individual survey questions for each content area. So let me just show you an example around that one. I think that will make this slide a little bit more concrete. Let's assume that we have a researcher who wants to create a survey around attitudes toward diversity in the workplace. So this person goes ahead, looks at the literature, reviews what's available, and talks to people in that area, like what people who are doing research in that area, or just people who are managers who have some workplace experience, like maybe company owners and different employers and employees, things like that. After getting all that information, now this person knows that there are several content areas that he or she needs to just cover. So for example, these could be attitudes toward minority coworkers, attitudes toward minority supervisor, and finally attitudes toward hiring or promoting minorities. Again, this person just came up with these three content areas under this construct of attitudes toward diversity in the workplace, based on literature review, observations, and expert views, and things like that. Now, the goal is that we know that our survey needs to cover these three content areas. What we need to do is to write or create some research questions under each of these content areas. Basically, what I need to ask right now, so to create those individual questions, is that, so what are the visible indicators of positive and negative attitudes towards minority coworkers? If I'm developing some questions, now it is still kind of like an abstract term, right? So attitudes towards toward minority coworkers. But how do I observe that? If somebody has positive or negative attitudes, then how can I see that in real life? What are those visible indicators? So make sure that your questions are based on those indicators, things that people can see themselves in, so more like behaviors, things, or maybe it could be still like thoughts, it could be still preferences, not like actions or behaviors, but still things that people will apply eventually. So that's why I just call them visible indicators, because if you keep your questions around abstract terms such as emotions, attitudes, or things like that, people may interpret them quite differently. So that's why you have to make sure that all those visible indicators that you are identifying are the key terms or key behaviors that will tell you more about, let's say, attitudes toward minority coworkers, attitudes towards minority supervisor, and things like that. So that visibility piece is the most critical part. And this is the part that I recommend you to take the time and just think more carefully, because we always end up writing very abstract, very kind of superficial questions, and people don't really understand those questions, and you end up getting really poor quality data at the end. So the more those indicators are visible, the more they are easy to decide on. So the more quality or higher quality data you will get at the end. So the primary goals of the question development process, there are two of them. The first one is you have to put yourself in a respondent state of mind or in their shoes to think about what would a respondent would say, what would they say if they took that question, or if I was a respondent in that case, what would I do? So what would I just pick in this question? So you have to see yourself in their seats or in their shoes to see as you like what they would just respond. So as a researcher, sometimes this is really hard to do, because you may think that your question is very clear, people will understand it in the way that you are writing it, but that may not be true. So you have to think about all the other people that you will be measuring or using in your study. So just to conceptualize, like, does this question really answer what I'm just hoping to answer at the end, the research question? Will people really understand this question the same way that I'm understanding it right now? So all those questions will help you guide your survey question development process. And the second thing is obviously to write clear and concise questions that can really differentiate respondents on the target construct. So I want to use this analogy. So if I'm, for example, if I'm creating an exam I would put some easy questions, some moderately difficult questions, and some highly difficult questions to measure really highly successful students, students who may not really know the area very well, and students somewhere in the middle. So some easy, some moderate, some difficulty to capture everybody in the population. And the same rule applies to surveys as well. So you have to create some questions to measure lower levels of whatever you are measuring, higher levels of that construct, and kind of like maybe medium level of that construct. So that's why you have to think about how to create some questions that will cover that continuum rather than only high levels, only low levels, or only moderate levels in that case. So a general suggestion is to keep your questions as short as possible. The more words you add, the more complicated they will get. They will become harder to read. People will skip your survey because your sentences are so lengthy. They may even just decline or refuse to participate in your survey after seeing a bunch of questions on your survey. So that part is really critical. We will talk a little bit more about that too. A couple of general guidelines. For each content area, I want you to just think about like how to create multiple questions basically. So it's not like you create 3-4 questions and you end up using them. We typically create almost like twice as many questions as we need eventually. So then eliminate the half of them. That's the best practice to do that. So create as many questions as possible. And then after the pilot study, you can just get rid of the poor quality ones and keep the good ones. Keep your questions as brief, as concise as possible. That's what I said. And avoid any words with multiple meanings or words from pop culture. People may or may not really be familiar with those. In that case, you don't want to risk that so that people would be second guessing what you were just meaning or asking the question. You don't want that. And use also positive phrasing instead of negative phrasing to reduce complexity. So sometimes you will see other survey researchers saying that ask some questions positively, ask some questions negatively. So that will mix up. So it's not like people are following a trend or they are becoming positively or negatively biased. I don't agree with that. So keep your sentences positive because our brain, our eyes, they read things positively. Even though you just say, I am not this, I do not like that. So in your sentence, in a survey, still people may just read it as like, I like it, I am this. So why do you just take that risk, right? So just write it positively. Don't mix up any negative phrasing unless your whole survey is negative. So that would be another strategy. If you want to keep your phrasing really negative, then keep everything negative so people know it from the beginning. It's not like back and forth. A couple of things to avoid in survey design. So this is one survey that I had received from Delta Airlines a while ago. So it is a good example of these double barrel questions, as we call them. So the double barrel questions are the questions that focus on multiple things in one place. So I will highlight one of them. So what was your overall satisfaction with the quality, taste, and presentation of the food offered? Okay, so I'm just reading that question. Overall satisfaction with the quality, taste, presentation of the food offered. Maybe I'm okay with the quality, but I did not like the taste. Maybe I'm happy with the taste, but I did not like the presentation. Then how am I going to answer this question? Excellent, very good, maybe fair. So this is one of those bad examples in that case because the question is asking three different things: your overall satisfaction with the quality, your satisfaction with the taste, and your satisfaction with the presentation of the food. So that's why those had to be three different questions rather than one, actually, because this question is right now, it's a double barrel question, meaning that it is focusing on more than one thing. So keep your questions around a single concept, single idea. Just ask only one thing in your surveys rather than putting and, commas, this. So like multiple things will give more complications to your survey and people will get confused. And you will see, this is me again, when I see this type of questions, when I see double barrel questions, and you will see people like doing the same thing. When they read this type of questions, they will get confused and they will not know what to choose and they will end up randomly choosing one of those response options. It is not necessarily good. This, like, even if this is not good enough, so even the second question is double barrel. How would you just rate the amount of food and beverage offered? Maybe I was happy with the food, but not the beverage. You know, in the flights, they give you a small glass of water and maybe orange juice or something like that. Maybe you are not happy with it, but you are happy with the food. So what are you going to choose in that case? Again, this is a double barrel question. And the question should have been split into like two separate parts rather than one. So you need to avoid this type of questions in your survey. Focus on one idea, one thing only in each question. A couple of other kind of mistakes to avoid, making some implicit assumptions. So for example, you can just ask in your survey, what was the best book that you read last year? And what if the respondent did not really read any books? So you assume that everybody reads, everybody who participates in your survey will read a book for sure, which may or may not be true. Or how often do you go to church? Maybe that's a question in your survey. And what if the respondent never goes to church? So again, your assumption is that they will go at least once or twice, so some frequency. But what if the person never goes to church, and then what are they going to choose? Another type of this type of implicit assumption is to assume that people will have the knowledge to answer that question. So for example, let's say we are creating a survey for students in elementary schools or secondary schools, and we just say that during the lunch break, our teacher meets with students who are having difficulty with their work. And can a student really definitely know whether the teacher is helping others during the lunch break? Maybe, maybe not. So in that case, we are having that assumption that students will have an idea about their teachers in that case, but that may or may not be necessarily true because of that assumption, basically, right? A couple of other things. So I would definitely recommend avoiding any specific determinants, so such as like only, never, all, always. So these are the type of words that you would use in a survey question, and that would steer the respondents towards choosing a particular response option. You are literally pushing them to choose a particular response option, either positive or negative, but that makes the question really limited in that case. So as an example, it says, as a ninth grade student, I come to school only because my friends are here. So strongly disagree, disagree, agree, strongly agree. And then you would just say, I come to school. Yes, I like my friends, but I also have other reasons. So should I say strongly disagree in that case or strongly agree? Do you know what I mean? You are literally pushing people towards a different direction just because you put that single word only, and that may become a strong determiner in that case. The abstraction is another thing that we typically do in survey research. And believe me, even like I would just make the same type of mistake because it is so hard to write survey questions. And sometimes we use abstract words to describe something, but that abstract word may or may not be clear to the respondents eventually. So for example, you may just ask that I found online math courses useful. Useful, okay. So what does that really mean? So useful is kind of like a meaningful word, but at the same time, it is quite abstract. Useful in terms of learning, useful in terms of timing, useful because it is convenient. So I don't know. So how are they going to interpret useful in that case? So that's why you have to make sure that you add at least few other words or just select more concrete words for people to think about actions rather than some abstract words in that case. Another example, what is the typical number of books that you read each month? So in that case, what do you mean with typical? Do you mean average? Do you mean the total number of books? So in that case, people may not really know what typical really means within this context. So those are the kind of examples that I want you to think about. So again, like this is very common. We all make the same type of mistake using this type of words because when I say like I found online math courses useful, I know that it is more about learning. So as a person who's creating the survey, I think about learning, but a student who is just taking the survey may not think about the same thing. So those are the things that's why I was just saying earlier, you have to put yourself in their shoes and think about how would a respondent really see that question. If they are an elementary school kids, or if they are like adults in other places, like in from a different cultural setting in other areas, or different countries, different languages. So you have to think about all those details as you are creating the survey questions one by one. One other thing that I will ask you to recommend is to check the readability of your question. So one thing that we know is that especially the general public questions or general public surveys are supposed to be kind of around the middle school or high school level. As the wording or the readability of your questions as gets more complex and complicated, and then people will struggle with your survey. They may not really understand it. They will just guess some answers randomly, and they may even just quit your survey, and they may just stop somewhere in the middle because your survey is really complex for them. So for general public surveys, we just say that keep your wording or readability of your questions around middle school, high school level. Now, how can you just check that? So there's an easy way to do it. Basically, as you are creating your survey, probably you are using a Microsoft Word or some other platform similar to that. But especially if you are using Microsoft Word, there's an easy way to check readability of your questions. So depending on which version of Microsoft Word you are using, either Microsoft 2016 or older, or if you are using the new one, Microsoft Office 365. So there are different buttons to do it. And when you run that spelling and grammar check or editor with the new version of Microsoft Word, with your question on the document that your questions are written, all of your questions, it will pop up a screen like this. So that screen shows all those readability statistics, and some of them are quite useful in that case. This flesh Kincaid grade level, the one that you see somewhere around here, but I will highlight that one, 8.3. So it shows that whatever the text that you put in that document, it is appropriate for 8th grade students. Like this 8.3 is like eighth grade, and maybe like 3 months or 3 months into 8th grade. So that's what the meaning of it. So now you know that your questions are suitable for an 8th grade student or around that area, or maybe higher level. So that's a good thing. So you want to keep that number around 8 or 9, possibly maybe 10. So because you want your survey to be around middle school or high school, not anything complex, more complex than that. So as you put more complex terminology, wording, and things like that, that number will go up. You will see 11, 16, 14, whatever. So, and that means those numbers are way too high. So your survey is way too complex, or in other words, it is not that readable. Another index that you may potentially use is the flesh reading ease. So any number between 60 or above would indicate better readability. And in our example, I just see that 68.5 is the number that I got. So I can say that probably this document or questions on this document are kind of readable, good enough. So 8.3, 8th grade students, and again, 68.5 is a good reading level. So check the readability of your questions before you go to the second round of piloting, testing, revising, and especially if you see this high numbers, like especially let's say you just see some high numbers in the flesh Kincaid grade level, meaning that your survey is way too complicated, you may want to go back and then think about your wording. Maybe cut some words, change them with simpler words, and just rewrite some of those questions. It is possible that you will end up replacing some of your questions because again, the readability is still not that good with your survey. So the reason that we are doing this again is that we want to make sure that everybody reads the survey questions and they understand the same thing. If they don't, then it is obviously problematic because they will start making their own interpretations, and survey data will be all over the place. It's not a good thing. Selecting a response scale. So there are lots of response scales that you could possibly choose for your survey, like knowledge skills. You can add true false items, yes, no, or option 1 and 2. The most common one is attitude scale. So I will just show this in the following slides, like Likert scale, such as strongly disagree, all the way to strongly agree. You may use rating scales such as numbers. So you can say that what's the level of your pain on a scale of 1 to 10? 1 means no pain at all, and high means very high pain. So that's a very typical rating scale, typically in health settings. And nominal scales such as like multiple choice items or some questions that you will just say select all that apply. So those are kind of like nominal items that we use. But again, the most common type of question that we use or scale that we use in surveys is the attitude scale, so, skills. Those are the Likert skills that we typically see. Strongly disagree, strongly agree, strongly dissatisfied, strongly satisfied. So that's why I will focus on that type of scale in the next few slides. A couple of questions that I typically receive from people. How many response options should I have in a survey? I just say that 4 to 7. Anything less than that, anything more than that will make your survey more complicated. And in that case, what I mean is that, let's say 4, strongly disagree, agree, strong agree, four response options, or seven, if you want to expand it even more. Typically four, five, six, seven is still quite extreme, but I would say four to seven is a good range. Anything beyond that and anything less than that will not give you a reliable scale at the end. Because either people will get confused because the scale is way too wide, they don't know where to pick, or the scale is too narrow and people end up choosing the same thing even though they are different. So let's say you just gave them only three options and that doesn't really reflect how much variation is going on in that whatever you are measuring. So people will end up choosing the same thing even though they are different people. So another question that I typically get is like, should I use either numeric or verbal labels for my response scale? And I recommend that you use both. So for example, you just label all the numbers. You just give people numbers, like let's say one is strongly disagree, two is disagree, three is, let's say, neither disagree nor agree, and four is agree, and five is strongly agree, something like that. So in that case, you have a scale, not only with labels, but also some numbers, so that gives people a sense of continuum. So more like numbers are going from low to high, less agreement to more agreement. So you are giving them a sense that as I just select higher numbers, I will be endorsing this, whatever that question is, but more strongly in that case. Should I have a middle option? So neutral, neither agree nor disagree. I would say that probably not. I'm not a big fan of those middle options because they really just create a lot of issues when it comes to analyzing data. So when you say neutral, when you say neither agree nor disagree, people typically jump into those options because they don't want to think about the question that much. So it's an easy escape for most people. So they will pick neutral, they will pick neither agree nor disagree. I would say that unless you have a good reason, you better avoid those middle options because, again, they are not very helpful in data analysis. And I even see people treating those middle options as missing. So which is even worse than just asking that, using that middle option in the first place. So that's why not to have that type of problem, unless it is really, again, necessary, just leave it out of your survey. Just try to create more like a homogeneous, like nice scale. I will just show you some examples in the next few slides, like how you can create symmetrical scales without putting these middle options. Couple of things, another point, should I use I don't know or no opinion in my response scale? Maybe, and especially if you have questions that require a certain amount of knowledge, or if you are unfamiliar, if you include some unfamiliar options in your questions and people may or may not really know what they are. So in that case, they may say, I don't know, or I have no opinion in that case. And I will show you an example of that one in the next few slides too. Otherwise, I see people asking very general, very plain questions, easy to answer, and they still have this I don't know or no opinion. Why would you just give people a chance to just escape from your survey? Again, I'm not saying that push people to or force them to take your survey, but at the same time, you are just literally giving them a chance to not to read the survey question itself and just choosing that option because they don't want to think about it. One typical issue as we are creating or building surveys is to create a balance scale. So you make sure that you have to make sure that you are creating equal numbers of response options for positive and negative ones. Otherwise, your survey response scale could be kind of biased towards either negative or positive views. So in the top row, you are seeing a bunch of questions. It says not at all important, somewhat important, kind of like negative, important, very important, extremely important, positive. So we have three positive options, two negative options. You are literally forcing people to choose a positive option rather than a negative option in that case because your response scale is not balanced. So you may want to just balance that out by eliminating some of those options. So in that case, not at all important, somewhat important, too negative, somewhat unimportant. It is kind of like a negative part of the scale, and somewhat important and very important, it is the positive part of the scale. And look at the wording. So very similar, very symmetrical. And in that case, people will not get confused and you are not adding any bias into your survey scale in that case. One common mistake that we typically do when we create surveys is also how to order the response options. So I see people starting from positive, going to negative, and they even start with low numbers to high numbers. that's kind of like a bad idea. So you will see two examples here, the top row and the middle row. So starting from very positive, going to very negative, and labeling them either from high to low or low to high, neither of them are really good. So the ideal way is that you sort everything from low to high and from negative to positive, because our eyes are reading things from left towards eye, towards right. So when I start reading things from the left side to the right, I'm just expecting some kind of increase. So in that case, if I just say that very dissatisfied on the left-hand side, very satisfied on the right-hand side, that's a really nice, easy to follow continuum. And in that case, you can add the labels, the numbers around that too, so that that really reflects that the higher the number is, the more satisfied with that statement. So for example, one is very dissatisfied, six is very satisfied in that case. So the higher numbers indicate higher levels of satisfaction. So just keep that kind of in mind, so that again, low to high, a negative to positive rather than the other way around, because it really confuses people. And I've seen so many surveys that people misread the questions. They thought that it was negative, they ended up choosing the positive response option, or they thought that it was a positive response option, they ended up choosing that, like the opposite of that one. So it is kind of interesting, because people may not really take the time to read all those questions carefully. They may get tired, and it is very easy to miss those details and make this type of mistake. So going back to that not sure does not apply options. So one recommendation I would make is that if you want to add this type of options to your survey, add them to the end. So there is research suggesting that when you add these options towards the end, only people who really need these options end up choosing them. And since they are not in the middle, they are not somewhere at the beginning, people typically just look at the whole response scale. And then if they are still not sure, then they pick that one. If it still doesn't apply and they pick the last option, which is quite separated by a vertical bar, or maybe like you may leave some space between the regular response option options and this does not apply or not sure option. So in that case, they know that that's a distinct response option. The remaining options are kind of valid, the regular response options in that case. So that really helps you distinguish, again, those people who actually can respond to the item and those who cannot. And that's why they end up choosing either does not apply or not sure option. So other than that, these questions or questions that I'm showing you here, they are violating the rule that I just showed you. So they are starting from positive going to negative. That's not good. And again, at the bottom, it says trust completely, not trust at all. So I would just say reverse that scale and reverse the numbers and go from 1 to 5 and all the way to not trust at all to trust completely. So maybe not a good example as a response scale, but it's a good example in terms of where to put those does not apply and not sure options. So let me share a bunch of 4-point and six-point scale options, so you may get some inspiration from those, because I typically see people choosing strongly disagree, strongly agree, or agree, strongly agree type of scale all the time, even though the question is not about agreement. So since we already know that type of response scale, we think that it can fit into like any type of question, but they typically don't. So when you ask a question that is not about agreement, and when you give them an option around strongly disagree, agree, strongly agree, people get confused. So they are like, what do you mean? So it's a frequency type of question, but you just say strongly agree. Or it is about quality, but you just said agreement. So do you know what I mean? It's more about like choosing the right scale for your questions is very important, rather than choosing a very generic scale for all of the questions. So in that case, these are kind of alternative options about frequency, endorsement, agreement, quality. Feel free to just pick up some of those. Again, you will find them in the slides. And let me show you a 6-point version, a wider scale, still symmetrical, still nice, and about same things, like same type of behaviors, agreement, frequency, endorsement, quality. And again, as you can see, disagree, strongly disagree is not the only option. You can say strongly opposed, somewhat opposed, somewhat favor, and things like that. Or if you are focusing on frequency, it goes from never to all the time. So those are the things that you may want to use in your survey, rather than, again, just choosing that kind of default option of strongly disagree all the way to strongly agree. Couple of extra points. So the number of questions is a big item. So people typically ask me, how many questions should I put on my survey? And there's no universal rule around that one, unfortunately. It depends on many things. It depends on your who is going to take your survey. Are they going to be motivated to take it? So, and how many questions do you need, or how many content areas you cover in your survey, things like that. But in general, I just say that the shorter is better. So basically ask fewer questions, keep your questions as short and concise as possible. That does the trick most of the time. But in general, I say that each content area requires at least 3 high-quality questions, not like 3 any questions, but 3 high-quality questions. Keep that in mind. Depending on how many content areas you are covering on your survey, each content area requires at least 3 questions. Sometimes I see people, even like publishing their surveys in journals, they say that I looked at people's preferences towards this, 1 question or 2 questions. Really? So can you really measure something with only 1 or 2 questions? I don't think so. So you need at least 3 questions or possibly more. So if you have some content areas that are more important than others, then use more questions in those than the areas that are relatively less important for your survey. Because the more questions you add, the more information you will get, the more reliable the information will be. In that case, my suggestion is that create as many questions as possible and retain the best questions after a pilot study. So your goal is to create or make a very, very long survey at the beginning and just get rid of the bad items after all, after just seeing the experts or running a pilot study and things like that. All right, so let's just have a short Q&A. I see a bunch of questions. Here, so it says, with implicit assumption questions, can you ask this if you provide an option of I don't read books, I don't go to church? Yes. So, and at least if you are giving an option that also covers the possibility of not reading books, not going to church, it would be possible. So some of those questions become so direct, assuming that like you will definitely go. But if you are adding the negative options, possibly, so yes, you can do that. Another question says, do you do this for each question or for overall survey, the readability statistics? You do this for the entire survey. Put all the survey questions in one document. Probably you will be creating your survey questions in a Word document anyway, and run the readability statistics on the entire document rather than individual questions. So that will give you an idea about the general readability of your survey. And depending on how bad it is, so you may want to focus on which items are more complex or questions are more complex and just simplify them. Do you recommend open-ended questions for people to add their opinions? Would that mean some kind of thematic qualitative analysis? Yes, so that's a very good question. I didn't want to get into open-ended questions in this case, but yes, I can definitely mention it. So personally, I do not find those open-ended questions that are placed near the end of the survey saying that, if you have any further ideas, please type it. Do you ever write anything in those boxes? I don't. And I'm a person who really likes surveys, and I don't type anything in those general comment boxes. A more strategic way to do it, to ask an open-ended question maybe after maybe each section, to, let's say, do you think that the government should change the health policies? Yes or no, and explain why. Something like this, more strategic. So in that case, going back to what you were asking, yes, a qualitative analysis would be necessary, because in that case, you will combine those answers, because people can type anything. So you will have to use some kind of thematic analysis to look for some common patterns in the responses, but also some variation, some diversity in the responses at the same time. So those are the typical things that we pay attention in open-ended survey questions. And I will mention some of those next week when I talk about how to analyze open-ended responses. But yes, that's pretty much it. So I would recommend having one or two open-ended responses, open-ended questions, and not many. And I would definitely recommend avoiding those general comment boxes at the end. Do you have any comments? Please type it. Again, most people will leave it empty.
Hey, Okan, it's Jeff. A quick question for you.
Sure, please go ahead, Jeff.
Getting back to the readability statistics.
Sure.
You talked about one of the ways to improve readability is to shorten the sentences, which makes sense. Are there other sort of common errors or sort of quicker fixes that you, more common issues that you come across that can help to improve the readability?
Sure. So, and I would just suggest that if you are combining multiple things, again, we have already mentioned that you should not have many ideas within one sentence, right? And this and that. So those kind of things should be avoided as much as you can. Another thing that will improve readability is to simplify wording. Your sentence may be already short, but you may have used some complex words, the words that the middle school or high school students may or may not necessarily know. In that case, you may want to think more about like, how can I just write this word in an easier way? Or maybe I can pick a more like a daily word that most people will know rather than this. So that will also reduce the complexity. But typically I noticed that as you shorten the sentences, that improves the readability significantly. And as you are just getting rid of those complex words, really lengthy words, like with many syllables and things like that, that also improves the readability at the same time. But again, it is more about creating a sentence that, like in layman terms, like creating something that will, like that, that can be understood by anybody. So I think that's the secret of it. And it's not an easy process, obviously. So you think about it, you're like, this is as simple as it gets, but somebody comes in and then I will mention it later on. So when you run pilot studies, people say that like, I was confused about this question. I'm like, really? So this is a very easy question to me, but that person says, no, I don't think so. I misunderstood this. So another way of doing that is to ask literally people in the pilot study to see how they would phrase it. So I think that could also help you understand what type of wording you might use alternatively. So to get inspiration from the people, like from real people, basically, the people who will end up taking that survey. And I see that, I think there's one question, raised hand.
Yeah, hi, my name is Stevie. I'm a very, very junior researcher with pediatric emergency medicine. Thank you so much. This has been so helpful.
Sure.
I'm working on a survey right now, looking at just different socio-demographic factors and people's careers. And one piece of feedback that I've received from, we're doing a Delphi process to get feedback. One piece of feedback that I've received is that people say, well, I've never experienced this, so I can't comment on it. Maybe you need to rethink this question. So if we ask about, you know, do you think disability impacts your career? Mm-hmm. People are saying, well, I don't have a disability, so I don't know. Do you have advice about how to phrase those questions? Because we still want people's opinions about how certain things might impact or whether they perceive it as something that could impact. So if you have any suggestions for things where people just feel like, I've never experienced this, so I can't comment.
Sure. I think that's a very good question. I think one easy fix to that problem would be to use something called branching. So asking an initial question such as, do you have any disabilities or have you experienced any disability? Yes or no. And if people say yes, then they follow up with the questions. And if they say no, they skip that section, move to the next one. Depending on the survey platform that you are using, and nowadays, I think every single survey platform could possibly just do that. So you can always have those kind of sections that could be given to people based on those conditions, like having a condition. Do you have any, have you experienced any disabilities in the last 5 years? I'm just giving you an example. If they say yes, then you just give them those following questions. If they don't, and you just say that if person chooses no, then jump to question whatever. So skip all those questions in between. So I think that would be an easy fix to that, because I know that right now there's not like an easy way to change the wording and they will still just say, I still did not experience that. I think the main problem is not having that experience or not having that experience is the main problem, as far as I understood from your comment. I think that would be like what I suggested would be a good fix to that problem.
Okay. Yeah. So branch logic. That's great. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. You're welcome. Any other questions? Again, I think that was a very good question. Again, Jeff, I appreciated that too, because readability is again, a big problem. And the statistics that I showed you in Microsoft Word is only one way of doing it. Still, you will get additional feedback from your participants as they read the questions. And I will mention that near the end of this training today, just to highlight what are the other things that that you should do as you are testing your questions. And one thing that you will do is to ask people like what they think of the questions. So, all right. So if there are no questions, then I will just move to the next one. Part three. So putting all the survey elements together in a typical survey, you will typically have like this kind of elements. You will have a survey title. You will have an introductory statement about your survey, a section where they will just show their consent, and they will be able to download the information letter, especially if you're running an online survey, obviously, and directions to complete the survey questions, and a thank you page or closing statement at the end. This is the typical like skeleton of a survey, either a paper-based survey or an online survey in that case. So the front page is actually quite important. We really just forget about that part, like how important it is to advertise your survey really nicely that you can catch people's attention. So if you have a really boring title, if you have like blah, blah survey, please come join us, do this. They're like, okay, I don't think I will. Do you know what I mean? So you need to just show your excitement as much as possible, even from the beginning introduction page. So in the front page, you may create a nice catchy title if you want. So if you have that kind of thing, so just to get their attention. Or you can have some kind of like a nice explanation around like how you appreciate their participation in the survey, what your survey is all about, using a motivational language, obviously. A number of questions, or especially expected time to complete, that makes a huge difference. This survey will take roughly 5 minutes to complete, 10 minutes to complete, rather than number of questions, because you may have very short questions, they may be easy to answer. So rather than giving them the number of questions, like I have 30 questions, but they are very short, and people will just say, whoa, 30 is too many. In that case, I would just say, put the expected time. Just take the survey yourself slowly and estimate the time in that case. And finally, you will also just say, you will receive blah, blah after completing the survey in case you are using any incentives. If you don't, then you can skip that part. And once they move to the second page, once they just show their consent, they just say that, okay, I agree to participate in the survey. That looks good. I will do it. So the starting part of the survey after the front page or after the introduction page will tell the respondents that they can exit the survey anytime. You are not forcing them to finish it. Respondents can go back and forth between the questions. So it's not like the questions are locked. They can skip questions, for example, and things like that. So giving people those kind of options, even though they can do it, they will figure it out already. It is kind of relaxing. It is good to know that I can skip questions. It is good to know that I can go back, change my responses. It is good to know that if I get tired, I can basically finish the survey and submit it anytime. Those are the things that you are just putting as a nice gesture. So more like just to be kind to your respondents in that case, even though, again, they will already figure it out by themselves anyway. But you are just kind of like creating that social connection with them as you are just giving the survey. So to gain their trust and as you are receiving their information in return. So here's an example. So this is an old survey from the US. So that was used at the Washington State University. So they started with this part. So it says, this is a great survey. We are just doing the survey for this reason. We want to understand how students feel about the quality of education here. And we hope that you will take a moment to complete this. And this survey is done by these people. So to give some credibility around that, who is behind the survey rather than a random survey with no information, that would be very bad. So putting your contact information at the beginning, saying that you are affiliated with the university, here's your email, who is responsible for that research project. All that information that you could possibly add to the front page will bring more credibility to your research in that case, to your survey. People will trust that, hey, this person is from the university. Okay, if something happens, I can contact this person. Probably they will never contact you, but still the information is over there. Things like that. So just make it as open as possible, as transparent as possible from the beginning, but still using a motivational language, obviously. Here's another survey introductory page from the city of Edmonton. They are running this type of public engagement surveys every now and then, either through telephone or just sending the link. So this is what they just used. And you know that this is through the City of Edmonton's website, so you already know who they are. They do not provide any links and stuff like that, but they also just say that your information will remain confidential. It will be helpful to improve public engagement activities. Please help out, stuff like that. So, and why you are eligible to participate in this study. So all those things will give people a sense of trust that, like, hey, this is real research. So this is. People have thought about this research rather than it's a random set of questions in that case. Bunch of online survey platforms I want to mention. So obviously Google Forms is one thing that many people use nowadays. It is free, you can create it through the university's account. So using Google Forms and save the data in your Google Drive. It's very easy to use, not very professional, not very customizable. Maybe that's the biggest drawback for Google Forms. It's very easy to put together some questions, a survey in using Google Forms, but at the same time, like even the branching option exists in Google Forms, like there are lots of nice features, but to me, so for a quick survey, it's good, but for a professional survey, maybe not. RedCap is another platform that is supported by the university, it is free. It is very good, but at the same time, it may look quite complex at the beginning. If you have the time, I would definitely recommend you to check out RedCap, because even though there is a high or steep learning curve at the beginning, learning all the details, like how to set it up, after that, I think you can create a very high quality survey, and the interface is very customizable. You can even just turn your survey into a printable paper-based survey eventually, send reminders to people automatically, get the data. And again, your data is stored at the university. That's also a good thing. I see a lot of people using Qualtrics. Many universities in the US and in Canada, sometimes they have the membership and sometimes they recommend using Qualtrics. It's a paid service and it is located in the US. So if you are collecting data that may be quite private or sensitive, then you may want to think about that one, because your data is not going to be stored in Canada in that case. That's always a concern to all of us. Data privacy, data security, that's one thing to keep in mind. Qualtrics is also very easy to use, so because it's a platform designed specifically for surveys, very nice, very, very easy to use, highly customizable, and there are a lot of built-in reporting and data analysis features. So once you finish your survey, you can get tons of reports, tons of figures, data analysis results, and things like that automatically. You can download the data really easily. Again, you are paying for it and you are getting something in return. So sometimes that investment really pays off. And finally, the last platform that I want to mention requires the R programming language. If you are familiar with it, I would definitely recommend you to check that out. I recently came across this. So it is called Form R. You can literally create your survey through Google spreadsheets, keeping it in the university server, and upload that Google spreadsheet to Form R database, and that creates a survey for you. Then you can start administering things. It is very flexible, very nice. There are lots of data visualizations, reporting tools, and other things. It can be quite tedious for people who are not knowledgeable about the R programming language, because it will require some knowledge for sure to set it up. But if you are already using R, then I would recommend you to check that out. Otherwise, still is worth learning and it is free. So it is a very good system to use. It can it allows you to create a lot of interactive items as you are building a survey. A couple of other interesting points before we finish up this section. So I will talk about how to group your questions, how to order your questions, and how to detect careless responses. So one thing that I will just suggest around grouping the questions, just group the questions based on the content and if the questions are logically related to each other. If the questions only share the same scale, it doesn't mean that they need to be combined together. Create different chunks in your survey. As people are reading through your questions, they should be able to understand what you really mean. So that part is really important. Ordering the questions is important. Basically, it motivates people to complete your survey. In that case, my recommendation is that start your survey with the most interesting questions. You don't want to put a really bland, boring question at the beginning, because that will really push a lot of people. They will just say, oh, okay, I don't want to take the survey. So it seems kind of tedious. It seems kind of long. Even from the beginning, they ask me a very sensitive question. I'm not going to do this. And they will just quit your survey. So start with the most interesting surveys, interesting questions to your survey. And the question should not be too long, too difficult, or sensitive at the beginning. And put all those sensitive and potentially objectionable questions near the end of the survey rather than the beginning. A couple of other things that I will mention. I don't want to dive into details of this process, but as you are thinking about your survey, and you will see that some people will be faking their responses, or they will be randomly choosing some of the response options. Either they will select the very first response option, like let's say strongly disagree for all of the questions, or they will select the last response option for all of them, strongly agree, or some people will read the questions and pick randomly, which is equally worse, equally bad in that case. So in that, like to detect this type of behaviors, you have to look at the data, and you have to just carefully analyze what's going on, whether it is random, whether it is systematic, it is careless responding. Is it really happening from the beginning, or did they start doing this type of behaviors somewhere in the middle or near the end? So to detect careless or fake responses to in your survey, you have a bunch of options, basically. You can literally ask your respondents their engagement level at the end of your survey. You can say that, can you tell us about your engagement level after completing the survey? Like maybe a scale to 1 to 10. They can say that, I was not really engaged, 5. I was really highly engaged, 8. So you can then trust their results. If somebody says, I wasn't really paying enough attention, 3. So maybe you may not want to just use that data from that person. This is a very effective option. So at the end of the survey, sometimes people just say, can we really use your data for research? Do you think that your responses are sufficient quality for use in research? And people just say yes or no. They may just say, I don't think so. I was randomly just browsing through the questions. So I don't think you can trust my results. No or yes, I was paying attention to the question. So they can guide you. So again, this is kind of like, it depends on their honesty. So they are still self-reporting their engagement with the survey. But if you want to do it more like a hidden way, so another way to do it, to create similar survey questions. And maybe you have a question at the beginning, maybe you have a similar version of the same question somewhere in the middle or near the end, to see if people will be giving you similar response options at the beginning, in the middle, towards the end. So this kind of like a checking mechanism to see how consistent they are. Were they really paying attention from the beginning up until the end? So this is kind of one technique. We call them shuttle questions. So in that case, you have one question that you are actually using, and there are similar versions of the same question, maybe somewhere in the middle or somewhere in the end. So then you compare the results between those two questions to see if people were still paying attention when they arrived at the middle part of the survey. And again, I know that this is quite quick, but I just see a bunch of questions. I have a bunch of questions that I will just try to answer. One comment says, our REB wants a boring front page, always a pattern, a typical format, no variations. Sometimes if they follow those type of guidelines, that's unfortunate. Yes, it is sometimes the case. But to be honest, like I did not have any difficulties with the ethics office up until now when I created my surveys. And I'm not just putting controversial things or some weird images or something in my survey to get attention, but I just try to make it as exciting as possible, and typically it works, so I didn't get any complaints. When you talk about choosing the best questions from among your pilot questions, how do you decide which are the best questions? We will come to that pretty soon, so I will answer that one. And do you recommend placing demographic questions at the end? Typically, I do. So unless the demographic questions are highly critical to your survey, I would say that keep the demographic questions near the end of the survey. First, you want people to take the survey and then tell you who they are. If it is the other way around, then maybe you can start with the demographic questions, but typically you want them to take the survey questions first and then just tell you who they are at the end. So put the demographic questions near the end, that's a better option. Another question is there a need to use shuttle questions in a short survey? Not really. The short surveys are already good, so I don't think people will have any difficulties like reading them or finishing them if the survey is really short enough, truly. So then you may not need something like this, but you may still consider adding that option. Can we trust your results or can we trust your responses? So that option is good. Again, I will go back to that question in the following section, the question about like how to select best questions. So we will now in our remaining time, we will go over those details, how to just run a pilot study, how to select best questions.
Okan, it's Jeff again. Just a quick point.
Sure.
I know some people will have to run to other commitments at 9:30. So we've got about 9 minutes to go through. I just wanted to, so everyone's aware that, do you want to stop at 9:30 sharp? Do you want to continue on knowing that we're recording so that people can catch up later? What's your
problem? I can definitely continue and finish it up. And if people need to leave, so they can definitely just leave, but watch the video after it's done. So, and I don't want the content to be missed, obviously. That's how we can just do it.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. All right, so let's just go to the final section. Hopefully we will still cover everything before we finish up. And finally, pilot testing the surveys. Going back to that question, like how do we decide which questions are the best questions and which questions we should just keep in our survey? So typically I would say that this involves multiple rounds of reviews. It involves an internal review, it involves an external review, and it involves a real pilot study. A pilot study where you will be getting in touch with people who will end up taking that survey eventually. So, and that's why you will be making those edits and further revisions, making further edits, making further revisions, and then maybe piloting your survey after that one. So it's a very long cycle. With the internal review, we can go over the questions to eliminate all the spelling error, grammar errors, awkward wording, punctuation errors. Personally, when I see a survey that includes some spelling errors, punctuation errors, I get distracted. And I think that even the researcher did not pay attention to the survey. Why would I take the survey really seriously? So this is how I take it. Maybe some other people may or may not be really careful about those details. But when I see that type of survey that has maybe typos, grammar errors, or punctuation errors, things like that, and I think that this is not really professional. So just to have that, to eliminate that problem, make sure that your survey is kind of like nice, clean, there are no errors, typos, anything. Another internal review checkpoint is to ask yourself whether you have enough questions to cover each content domain or each content area. Remember, I mentioned that you need at least three questions to measure each content area, and those three questions have to be really high quality questions. Now, after your revisions, after your pilot, you may realize that you have two questions left, only one question left. Either you create two more and go around that piloting stage one more time just to see if the new items are better. Or if you feel like you cannot create good items, maybe eliminate that content from your survey for the sake of making your survey shorter and better. So rather than having some random questions that measure one thing or another, so I would say that focus on the most important aspects that you want to measure. And if you are not able to create good questions around it, maybe leave it out of your survey. External review means that you are selecting your survey with reviewers who are not directly involved in your survey, because you want them to be, you want them to have fresh eyes. You want them to be unbiased. In that case, though, they will look at your project, they will tell you if something is wrong. So, and those people could be experts in your field, people who are experienced with survey design or collecting data from people, people who are experienced with the members of the target population. And again, you can just definitely just go and talk to those people, show them your survey and get their opinions. Like, what do you think? And in that case, you can ask them to comment on the instructions to complete the survey, the questions themselves, the response categories, even the visual design of your survey. You can ask people whether you think it is kind of accessible, nice, clean, and easy to follow. So also you have a good option, which is called pilot study. So give your survey to people to test it for sure. So in that case, your options are either you can give your survey with potential respondents from your target population. In that case, those are the people who have who are eligible to participate in your survey eventually. So I suggest that you include more than 30 people in the pilot study, because you will be collecting quantitative data, and quantitative data fewer than 30 people, it's not that helpful. So you want to collect as much data as possible before you make any decisions on the pilot data. So you may say that, hey, I'm already dealing with a very small population, so I cannot use 30 people. That's fair. But if you are dealing with a large population, if you feel like you can pick or find 30 participants who may end up taking your survey eventually, people who are part of the target population, give them your survey and just let them take it and see what's going on. Another alternative option that most people don't know about is to run individual interviews with respondents. So basically what you can do is to select a diverse group of people, 5 to 10 participants, meet with them individually and give them your survey. And I will just explain how that really works out. But literally you are discussing each question one by one, or the most important questions on your survey, and you ask them to interpret the questions, not to answer the questions, but interpret them. So let's say you just did the pilot study and then you got the pilot data back, quantitative data. You did it with 30 or more people, and then you will just take a look at a few things, such as, are there any questions that most respondents were not able to or willing to answer? So maybe that's a red flag. So, and did you observe any of the following, for example, like all respondents chose the same response option in a particular question? That's really bad. So it means that there's no variation. You got a consensus on that question, but you did not get a real response. If everybody's picking the same response option, it's not a question. It's really a consensus. It's a yes, no type of question anymore. So maybe you may want to change that or eliminate that question. Most respondents ended up choosing not sure, I don't know, or neutral options. Again, not a good sign. Maybe you may want to consider eliminating those options and also figure out why they end up choosing those response options rather than the other things. And also most respondents, let's say they chose the extreme response option, such as only strongly disagree or only strongly agree. In that case, you may want to figure that out. So maybe your questions are a little bit more extreme, so they are pushing people towards those extreme response options. You may want to use a milder language in your questions, or maybe you may want to revise them a little bit further so that extreme response behavior will disappear. And finally, you can ask people who participated, did the selected platform for survey administration really work for everybody properly? So that's another question to think about. Again, going back to the second option, the conducting individual interviews. So like I said, the respondents, in that case, you are meeting with them individually, 5 to 10 people, just choose a very diverse group, like different racial groups, ethnic groups, gender groups and things like that. So just bring them together, 5 to 10 people, and you meet them individually. And this is called a think aloud procedure, or think aloud protocol. So you are running this think aloud interviews with them. So you are literally asking them to think aloud as they are reading the question. So, and comment on the questions. So they just read the question, they tell you what they think of the question, and they explain what the final response would be for them and why, how they came to that conclusion or how they ended up choosing that response option. And in that process, you need to ask some probing questions, such as, what do you think that this question is asking you? Or can you repeat the question with your own words? Or can you explain what affected your choice at the end? So this type of questions will give you some ideas about how much they understood the questions. Is there any unclarity in the questions? Are they happy with the length of the survey, number of the questions? Are they happy with the wording? Were they ever confused or what? And if you want to just create this type of procedure, I would say that be ready to spend up to 10 hours or so as you are meeting with people, because each interview takes around like 45 minutes to an hour, depending on the number of questions on your survey, sometimes even longer. And you will have to also just take notes as you are meeting with people. So that's a lot of work, but it pays off. If you want to do this type of procedure, I would definitely recommend you to check out this link that I shared in the slides over here. So there's a full page think aloud protocol that summarizes how to run this type of interviews with people. So it starts from the beginning, how to set it up, what type of questions you can ask, and things like that. It's a one page, a brief page that I prepared for you. I think that was it, Jeff. So I think maybe I just finished everything in time. Almost. Yes, it's 9:30. I know that we just finished. There's not much time left for people to stay on, but I'll be happy to stay on and take further questions.
Well, that was right on time, Okan. So like you had a plan. So thanks very much. That was wonderful, covering a lot of relevant issues. I got feedback from people, a really positive session today. So thank you. If people have to run, please go ahead. If there are any questions, why don't we dive into that?
I see one question in the chat, two questions. So thank you again. Liz just said thank you. Looking forward to the next week's session. Yes, definitely. Just please join us next week as well. Thank you for coming in and joining us this morning. I know that it's an early morning, but it is never a bad time to learn about surveys. So at least that's how I think about it.
Maybe while people are sending their thank yous, can you just give a teaser for what the next session is about as a refresher for everybody?
Sure. So in the next session, I'm planning to focus on how to analyze survey data briefly. So I'm not going to go over a lot of statistical analysis, but I just want to give you some options to think about. So how to analyze survey data and maybe some common mistakes in analyzing survey data. And I also want to show you a bunch of tools that would be helpful when you analyze and visualize survey data, because not only analysis, but also like presenting survey data becomes quite challenging sometimes, because yes, sir, your survey is done, then it is a good time to think about, like, how am I going to present these findings? Am I going to present each question? Am I going to present a group of questions together? What type of figure should I choose? That's what we are going to talk about in the next session to guide you around, like, what to put in publications and presentations.
Great, thank you. I see there's one question here from Daniel Garros about...
There's an article about how to test surveys by Karen Burns. I think I remember that one, but I don't remember the content, to be honest. Like, I don't know if I can comment on it right now. The talks about sensitivity and specificity on surveys. I will check that out. I will have to check that out. There are so many checklists, general guidelines around surveys. But again, the survey research is so interesting, so unique. So sometimes those guidelines become kind of like quite limited. And sometimes some guidelines do not necessarily apply. I think I would be curious to look at those that article. So yeah, thank you so much.
Yeah, please send it away, Daniel.